This morning, I'm continuing the message series called Learning Life the Hard Way. There's an easy way to do things, and there's a hard way to do things. The Old Testament character Moses seems to always find the hard way. There's always a struggle, a tension, a conflict, and just when you think everything is going Moses' way, another difficulty makes life hard once again. Last week, we took a look at Moses' birth story. Moses was born into a world of pain, cruelty, and slavery. As a boy Hebrew baby, Moses' life was supposed to end by being drowned in the Nile River. But God worked through some courageous women to keep baby Moses alive. As a young boy, Moses moves from his Hebrew family to an Egyptian family where he grows up as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. There he receives the best possible education in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. The Bible gives no further details about Moses' teenage years or young adult years. The story in Exodus jumps ahead to a pivotal decision that Moses makes at the age of 40. Now, Moses knows that he's a Hebrew, and the Israelite slaves are his biological people. Those are his brothers and sisters who are suffering under Egyptian cruelty. Yet Moses also knows that he's the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He enjoys a privileged status among the Egyptians. And one day, he just might occupy the throne of Egypt. Moses must decide. He has to make the biggest decision in his life. Will I continue to identify myself as an Egyptian and spend the rest of my life enjoying the pleasures of my favored position? Or will I identify myself as a Hebrew and cast my lot with a distressed and abused people? What will Moses decide? What would you decide if you were Moses? If you have your Bible, I invite you to open it to the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 2. Moses makes his critical decision, and he experiences the aftermath of that decision in Exodus, chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. Beginning with verse 11, one day after Moses had grown up, he went out to where his own people were and watched them at their hard labor. He saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his own people. Glancing this way and that, and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. The next day he went out and saw two Hebrews fighting. He asked the one in the wrong, "Why are you hitting your fellow Hebrew?" The man said, "Who made you ruler and judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me as you killed the Egyptian?" Then Moses was afraid and thought, "What I did must have become known." When Pharaoh heard of this, he tried to kill Moses. But Moses fled from Pharaoh and went to live in Midian, where he sat down by a well. Now a priest of Midian had seven daughters, and they came to draw water and fill the troughs to water their father's flock. Some shepherds came along and drove them away. But Moses got up and came to their rescue and watered their flock. When the girls returned to Reuel, their father, he asked them, "Why have you returned so early today?" They answered, "An Egyptian rescued us from the shepherds. He even drew water for us and watered the flock." "And where is he?" he asked his daughters. "Why did you leave him? Invite him to have something to eat." Moses agreed to stay with the man. who gave his daughter Zipporah to Moses in marriage. Zipporah gave birth to a son, and Moses named him Gershom, saying, I have become an alien in a foreign land. Today I want us to look at the theme, God works through our failures. Moses makes some critical decisions, and the result is that he ends up changing residence from Egypt to Midian. And this journey from Egypt to Midian involves four steps. And we might call them the four steps of working through failure. So let's look at them. Step number one, Moses' motive is right. Verse 11 states that Moses went out to where his own people were, and he watched them at their hard labor. The verb watched means to look with emotion. He's moved in his heart. He's basically captivated in his spirit, and he feels sympathy for his people. Although educated as an Egyptian, Moses is a Hebrew at heart. He sees the Israelite people as his brothers and sisters. They belong to him, and Moses wants to help them. His heart is with them, and his motive is right. Moses gets angered by injustice. He can't just sit back and do nothing when he sees wrong taking place. He has to get involved and do something. Moses attacks and kills an Egyptian who is beating a Hebrew. He sees two Hebrews fighting with one another, and he confronts the one who's in the wrong. Moses drives away some shepherds who are harassing seven young women. Moses has compassion for those who are picked on, harassed, and oppressed. And he has the courage to take action and protect those who are being mistreated. Moses has the right motive. Is there an injustice that bothers you? Maybe it's senior adults who feel all alone with no family to help them. Maybe it's teenagers who don't have a spiritual leader to help them figure out their answers to their spiritual problems. Maybe it's children who need a safe adult who will teach them and show them what it means to be loved by God. Maybe it's adults who don't have enough money to buy food to support their families. Maybe it's adults who've lost their way in life and they just need someone to help them start over again. What group grips your heart and motivates you to help them? Step number two, Moses' method is ridiculous. When Moses observes an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, verses 11 and 12 indicate that Moses takes matters into his own hands. He looks all around him, sees no one watching, kills the Egyptian, and tries to bury him in the sand. Moses acts on impulse, wrongly thinking that the time has come for him to liberate his fellow Hebrews. Moses has the right motive, but his method lacks wisdom. There's no indication that Moses is following God's leadership when he takes this drastic action. To the contrary, Moses is relying upon himself and his own abilities to rescue his people. And Moses' method is ridiculous, because there's no way he can single-handedly wipe out all the Egyptians, one taskmaster at a time. Moses knows that it's God's will for the Israelites to be set free. The problem is that Moses never takes time to seek God's plan and God's timetable. Instead, Moses develops his own plan according to his way and his schedule. Chuck Swindoll says that Moses dedicates himself to the will of God, but not to the God whose will it is. Moses is going to learn the hard way that God's work must be done according to God's methods. We must learn that same thing as well. We must carry out God's work according to God's methods. It's not enough just to have the right motive. We also must have the right method. And we must learn that it's never okay just to take matters into our own hands and leave God out of the picture. Instead of acting on impulse, we need to learn to seek God. Instead of just voting our opinion, we need to learn to seek God. Instead of just following conventional wisdom, we need to learn to seek God. If we try to do what we think is God's will without consulting His opinion, we may lose God's blessing in the process. God will only bless what He ordains. So before we act, we must humble ourselves. We must seek God's direction. We must discern His timing and allow the Holy Spirit to lead us. Like Moses, many Christians have the right motive, but they're making a mess of things because they haven't taken the time to seek out God's method. They're relying upon their method, and their method is ridiculous. Someone once observed that life is so difficult because, unlike school, in life you take the test first and the lesson comes later. The board of directors at a bank recognized that there was a young man who had all the qualities they were looking for in a successor to the bank president who was about to retire. And one day this young man meets with the bank president and he says to him, "As you know, soon I will succeed you as president of this bank, and I would greatly appreciate any advice that you could give me." The president says to him, "Son, sit down. I have two words for you. Right decisions." The young man thinks about that for a while and says, "I can see how that's helpful, sir. But how does one go about making right decisions?" "One word: experience." "Well, I can see how that's helpful, sir, but how does one go about gaining experience?" "Two words," said the bank president: "wrong decisions." Moses makes a wrong decision. Have you made any wrong decisions? Have you acted in haste without seeking God? Have you relied upon your own wisdom and made a mess out of everything? Did you just go along with popular opinion and never bothered to ask God for His opinion? Do you have some things buried in the sand because you acted foolishly without God's blessings? Have you learned the hard way that it's always best to do things according to God's methods? Step number 3, Moses' misery is realized. Failure always comes with a price tag. Wrong methods result in woeful consequences. Moses is going to learn the hard way that his hasty decision is going to bring him heavy misery. Moses' misery comes from three sources. First, his own people reject him. I mean, Moses lays it all on the line for the Hebrews, but the Hebrews want nothing to do with him. The Hebrew offender says to Moses in verse 14, "Who made you judge and ruler over us? Who are you?" Talk about a blow to Moses' ego. Wrong methods can bring misery, the misery of rejection and remorse. Second, Pharaoh wants to kill Moses. Even though Moses looks all around him, before he kills the Egyptian, somebody saw him do it. And that somebody is spreading the story faster than a Facebook post. The offending Hebrew says to Moses, "Are you thinking about killing me just like you killed the Egyptian?" Well, the rumor eventually reaches Pharaoh, and Pharaoh tries to kill Moses. And now Moses is a traitor and a wanted man. Third, Moses flees to Midian. Verse 15 states that Moses fled from Pharaoh and went to live in Midian. Midian is a barren wasteland. The contrast with Egypt is shocking. Moses goes from having every convenience and luxury in Egypt to living in a barren wasteland located somewhere in the boondocks. When Moses reaches the well at Midian, his misery must have been overwhelming. Moses must have been thinking to himself, "My life is over. I messed up a really good thing. I had everything going for me. Now I have nothing. I mean, God must be finished with me too. My life is done." Have you ever experienced such misery? You messed up, and you come to the conclusion that there's no way you'll ever recover? I mean, your heart was in the right place, but your actions were deplorable. And now it's over. You think, "God can never use me again. I've messed up too many times. I didn't know what I was thinking. My life is a mess, and I'll never recover." Step number four, Moses' maturity is required. Moses will spend the next 40 years in Midian. He gains a family. He gains a new career. Verses 21 and 22 state that Moses marries Zipporah, and she gives birth to a son named Gershom. Moses is now working as a shepherd for his father-in-law in the land of Midian. Moses spends the first 40 years of his life living in a palace. The next 40 years will be spent living outdoors with the sheep. A promising junior executive for IBM involves the company in a risky venture that ends up with a $10 million loss. Tom Watson, IBM's founder, calls the nervous executive into his office, and the young man blurts out, "I guess you want my resignation." Watson replies, "You can't be serious. We just spent $10 million educating you. God is in the business of educating people who failed. D.L. Moody puts it this way, Moses spends his first 40 years thinking he's somebody. He spends his second 40 years learning that he's nobody. And he'll spend his third 40 years discovering what God can do with a nobody. God uses the wilderness to teach Moses what the palace could never teach him. The palace teaches Moses all about Egyptian culture, philosophy, and religion. And Moses learns economics, construction, and the arts. But the wilderness teaches Moses some more important things. Moses is going to learn humility, perseverance, self-discipline, character, and faith. God is going to use the wilderness to mature Moses to the point where he's ready to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. Moses learns to care for and lead his wife and son before he's ready to care for and lead over 1 million Israelites. Moses learns to care for and lead sheep for 40 years before he's ready to care for and lead over 1 million Israelites. God wants Moses to mature in the small things before he's ready to promote him to bigger things. God isn't finished with you if you're in the wilderness. In fact, God does some of His greatest work in you during your wilderness seasons. Now, you may think you're in the wilderness because you messed up in the past. You may think God can't use you because of your past failures. But the good news is that God doesn't use the wilderness to terminate you. He uses the wilderness to train you. God wants to mature you in some small things before He's ready to promote you to greater things. God doesn't want failure to be the last word in your life. Now, you may have messed up in the past. You may have gotten some things wrong. Your heart was in the right place, but your methods were terrible. You said some things and you did some things without thinking through the consequences. But now, God wants to mature you. He wants to grow you. He wants you to be faithful in the little things as you make progress toward the person He wants you to be. God wants to teach you how to serve, how to trust, how to obey. You may be in a wilderness today, but God didn't put you there because He's finished with you. He puts you there to fine-tune your character. So allow God to work in you so that one more time, God can work through you. Failure isn't final. The good news is God works through our failures. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this incredible story. Father, this is a story that could have ended in tragedy. But Father, you're the kind of God who works through our failures. You're the kind of God who doesn't give up on us just because we get it wrong. You're the kind of God who's there to train us, to mature us, to grow us. And even in our failures and mistakes, that's not the end, because you're not finished. The story isn't over. Moses' story does not end in Exodus chapter 2. And Father, may our story not end in failure either. May we see your goodness and your grace. May we surrender to you. May we allow you to develop us into the person you want us to be. Thank you, God, that you don't give up on us. There's a new opportunity. There's a new chance right around the corner if we'll just grow and mature in you. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.